I'm Alex Villarreal with the VOA Special English Technology Report. Today, we tell about some of the top technology developments of the last 10 years. The technological revolution is changing the way we work and play. Mobile phones became smartphones with abilities like computers. Many people started reading books on electronic readers. Televisions became high definition, and the screens became flat. Digital music players got smaller in size, but large enough for people to download their entire music collections. Worldwide broadband subscriptions passed 500 million. And at least 2 billion people were expected to be online by the end of 2010. Stephen Baker is the Vice President of Industry Analysis for the Consumer Electronics Market Research Group, NPD. He says the technological developments of the 21st century have brought about some historic advances in consumer electronics. He said 10 years ago might as well be 100 years. If you look back at the way people interacted with electronics in 2000 and the way they interact with them today, there is no comparison. 10 years ago, there were no flat panel televisions. There were no mobile web devices or smartphones. There were no ebook readers. And very few people had notebook computers. Bruce Bockenheimer is with the MIT Enterprise Forum in New York City. He is also the director of entrepreneurship at Pace University. He talked about what he believes are the most important technological developments of the 21st century. They are mobile computing, digital media content, broadband, social media platforms, and user-generated content. Also, digital photography and global positioning systems for consumers. Mr. Bockenheimer says all of these things have worked together to revolutionize technology. And he says the technology is constantly changing, faster than at any other time in history. He said telephones had not changed for 3 or 4 decades. They could be on a wall or on a tabletop. But now, cell phone technology is changing every year. He asked, how many people have a cell phone that is more than a year or two old? For VOA Special English, I'm Alex Villarreal. You can learn more about technology on our website, voaspecialenglish.com. And you can follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and iTunes at VOA Learning English.
This is the VOA Special English Economics Report. In early April, President Obama announced his plans to seek re-election in November of next year. In an email to supporters, Mr. Obama said, "The race may not reach full speed for a year or more." But he said the work of building the campaign must start today. Some of that work will depend on how many jobs are created in the months ahead. Mr. Obama welcomed a report that the United States economy added 216,000 jobs in March. The unemployment rate dropped 0.1% for the second straight month. The unemployment rate edged down to 8.8%, the lowest in 2 years. And some economists say this spring may be the start of better news to come. Consumer spending has been increasing. Stephen Hess is a political scientist who studies the presidency at the Brookings Institution in Washington. He says the next election will more than anything else depend on employment in the United States. Labor Secretary Hilda Solis pointed out that the economy has added jobs for 12 months in a row. She says the economy has added 1.5 million private sector jobs. But, she added, we need to continue to not lose sight of where we need to go to increase opportunities for people to get employed in new jobs. President Obama has filled a top job in his party as he prepares to seek a second term. He chose Representative Debbie Wasserman Schultz of Florida to head the Democratic National Committee. She replaces Tim Kaine, who plans to run for the Senate from Virginia next year. Among Republicans, former Minnesota Governor Tim Pawlenty recently formed a committee to explore a presidential campaign. Several other Republicans are also considering races for their party's nomination. The latest jobs report showed that 13.5 million Americans remained unemployed in March. Another concern is that oil prices remained over $100 a barrel. High energy prices could threaten the recovery from the recession. In another development, Portugal became the latest member of the European Union with heavy debts to request emergency loans. Portugal joined Greece and Ireland, which have also received aid. Portuguese opposition parties refused to accept budget cuts proposed by Prime Minister José Sócrates. For VOA Special English, I'm Carolyn Prasuti. For more ways to learn American English and stay informed every day, go to voaspecialenglish.com from your computer or mobile device.
I'm Mario Ritter with the VOA Special English Agriculture Report. Cacao or cocoa trees grow in hot, rainy areas of Africa, Asia, and Central and South America. Their beans are used to make cocoa powder, cocoa butter, and of course, chocolate. There are 5 to 6 million growers, maybe more. Many are poor family farmers with only a few hectares. West Africa produces more than half of all cocoa beans. Ivory Coast leads the world in production, followed by its neighbor, Ghana. The trees are usually in their fifth year when they start to grow the pods that contain the beans. The trees produce the most pods when they are 10, but they are still productive long after that. Workers use large knives to cut the lower pods and long tools to remove pods from high on the trees. Later, they break open the pods to remove the beans. A half gram of chocolate requires about 400 beans. The World Cocoa Foundation says an average pod contains 20 to 50 beans. And experts say growers may lose perhaps one-third of their harvest to disease and insects. But now scientists have genetic maps of two kinds of cocoa trees. These genomes are mostly complete and could lead scientists to new ways to increase production and prevent disease. Mapping genes is the first step to understanding an organism. Next comes learning the job of each gene. The American food company Mars took the lead in paying for mapping the genes of the Forastero cocoa tree. The Forastero provides 80 to 90% of the world's cocoa beans. Mars depends on those beans for its M&Ms and other chocolate candies. The company's research partners included several universities and the United States Department of Agriculture. The average West African cocoa farmer produces about 400 kilos of beans per hectare. But Howard Yana Shapiro, head of plant science and external research at Mars, thinks that science could greatly increase the yield. A competitor of Mars, Hershey's, supported the gene mapping of the Criollo, a far less common cocoa tree. CIRAD, a French government research center, led scientists from 6 countries in creating that genome. We'll talk more about the cocoa industry next week when we look at efforts to help child laborers in Ivory Coast and Ghana. For VOA Special English, I'm Mario Ritter. You can read and listen to our reports at voaspecialenglish.com.
I'm Carolyn Prasuti with the VOA Special English Education Report. The international primary curriculum is an idea that began in Britain 8 years ago. Today, this curriculum is taught in more than 1,000 primary schools in 58 countries, including the United States. Educator Martin Skelton co-wrote the International Primary Curriculum, or IPC. He says for children to learn and succeed, they need a program that permits them to learn individually. He says the idea with the curriculum is to help today's children become good citizens of the world and 21st century leaders. He says most of world problems are going to be solved internationally. No single country is going to solve the environment or terrorism. Mr. Skelton says the curriculum has activities built around the development of international mindedness, starting from the age of 5. The British American School of Los Angeles is one of a few American private schools that teach the international primary curriculum. Second grade teacher Allison Kerr says the main goal is to engage children in the learning process. This term, for example, her class is learning about people important in history. She says the children dressed like famous people. They had to research and bring 10 written clues, and the rest of the class had to guess who the people were. The British school in Boston held a fair for students, and parents called around the world in a day. Emma Northey, head of primary learning at the school, says 51 nationalities were represented. She described one activity designed to teach about similarities among different cultures. She says the children were each given a passport. They knew that they were going around the world in a day. We said to them, "You have to come back with two similarities that you had seen between the different cultures. Even the three-year-olds came back to me saying, "Gosh, you know everybody writes. Some people write going down. Some people write from left to right. Some from right to left." Another educator, Kate Foy, of the British School in Washington, says the teacher's role is to enable students to discover for themselves. For VOA Special English, I'm Carolyn Persutti. Tell us if you have experience with the international primary curriculum and what you think of it. Share your comments at voaspecialenglish.com or on Facebook and Twitter at VOA Learning English.
It is hard to believe that New York City was once a small Dutch settlement. An old document shows that Dutch settlers did, in fact, pay for this land. The document can be seen at the city's South Street Seaport Museum. Martin Berense is head of the Netherlands National Archives. He says the letter tells about a ship arriving in Amsterdam. The ship's operator said, "The settlement is going well, and we bought the island of Manhattan for 60 guilders." The letter is on loan for New York's 400th anniversary. Berense says the letter tells about the settlement which became New York. The museum also has a map of the settlement. Another map shows just how small Manhattan was. That changed when Britain took control. Historian Barry Lewis says the British filled in part of the East River with waste because more land was needed.
We had only about 100,000 people at the beginning of the 19th century. By 1875, the population of Manhattan is 1 million people. By 1910, over 2 million people are living in Manhattan Island.
The Brooklyn Bridge was built in 1883, so people could move to Long Island, where land was less costly. Lewis says people crossed the East River by carriage or boat, or they walked across the bridge. He says New York's underground trains led to the development of land in areas far from the center of the city. Many businesses needed to be in Manhattan, so developers started building up, creating the skyscraper.
People were afraid it would fall down in the first windstorm, and anyone who had property in the commercial buildings next to it, they were terrified that nobody would rent in their buildings because that thing was next door.
But more and more skyscrapers were built. Each one was higher than the next. Lewis says the big reason for so many skyscrapers was money. He says New York was built by investments in land. That is not why everything was built. Some structures have improved the look of the city. Two examples are the Washington Square Arch and the Guggenheim Museum. But money is still important on the island that began as a trading center 4 centuries ago. The area the Dutch settled is now Wall Street, the world's financial capital. I'm Steve Ember.